afternoon. My name is Rachel James. I'm here on Stan the Energy Man. Clearly, however, I am not Stan, who is out today, so I am guest hosting for his show, Stan the Energy Man, which is on every Friday at 12 noon here at thinktechhawaii.com. This month, we've been talking to folks in the community about energy and transportation and transportation energies. And so this afternoon, we have Deputy Director of Harbors from Department of Transportation, Darrell Young. Darrell, welcome to Stan the Energy Man. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Rachel. Thanks for having me on the show.
We're glad to have you. So if you could tell us a little bit about what does Harbors do? What are your areas of concern and responsibility?
We're our organization is about 247 members strong. We run 10 commercial harbors throughout the state. We have two on Kauai, Port Allen and Ōiliwili. Two on Honolulu, Honolulu Harbor and Kalailoa Harbor. We have four in Maui County. We have Kamalapau and Lanai. We have Kaunakakai and Molokai. We have Hana and Kahului on the island of Maui. And on Hawaii Island, we have the ports in Hilo and Kauai High. So we primarily take care of the shipment of goods throughout the state of Hawaii, goods and passengers. As I like to explain to people, if you think about Hawaii as a pie, 80% of all goods that we consume is imported. And of the 80%, 99% of that comes in through our harbor system.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's an awesome responsibility, but we're trying to have a lot of fun while we're doing it.
That's important.
Yeah.
I'm glad you can still think of it lightly, because as you're saying that, I'm like, that's a lot of shipping.
Yeah.
That's a lot of shipping. So if you could tell us a little bit about what you've done most recently and how that's informed your work with Harbors now.
So I've been the deputy at Harbors since February of last year, thanks to Governor Ige and our director, Ford Fujigami. Prior to that, I was the deputy director for the Department of Hawaiian Homelands. And then prior to that, I was the chief of staff for former council member Nestor Garcia in the Honolulu City Council for 10 years.
Outstanding.
Yeah. So the way it shaped me is doing those things, I had a chance to see a lot of the land transportation with my stint with Nestor. From the Department of Hawaiian Home side, I got a chance to see a lot of the land use, land disposition process.
Right.
Through the government eyes. And then that's kind of allowed me to look at it from the water side at Harbors.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
I find it interesting, some of your experience with transportation with the city council.
Yeah.
And we joked a little bit coming in that now you're taking it from the land to the sea.
Yeah,
but it's pretty encouraging to see that you're able to take some of those lessons and just, I guess, some of those skill sets and apply them here for Harbors.
As I mentioned, it was kind of surreal yesterday watching the two rail cars come in, knowing that we were there at the city council when the city council actually voted to support the rail transit project. So, you know, we're trying to see what we can do also at Harbors to see how we can incorporate some elements of transit-oriented development down on the public side of our harbors. We try to separate our cargo and our public side.
I see.
So that you don't have cross purposes. When I say public side, we have two areas in Honolulu that we consider public or semi-public. It's Aloha Tower and the Aloha Tower Marketplace, as well as the domestic commercial fishing village where Uncles and Nico's is. Down at Pier 38.
I see. As you mentioned that, I'm like, oh, that's a good spot to go for lunch here.
And actually, Jim is building a new restaurant there. So
very good.
Should be open in about 60 days.
Okay. So I'm glad that you mentioned that partnership that you're seeking with perhaps TOD.
Mm-hmm.
If you could talk a bit about some of your federal partners and if there are other partners in different governments, kind of how Harbors works to accomplish their mission there.
Yeah. We work very closely with the U.S. Coast Guard.
Okay.
A lot of the responsibility of the Coast Guard is the protection of commerce and and the flow of commerce. And so we work very well with Captain Shannon Gilreth. Unfortunately, he'll be terming out or transitioning out on June 30th, and we'll miss him. He's been a really strong supporter of Hawaii Harbors and what we do. We have a close working relationship with our shipping partners as well. We have a group called the Hawaii Harbors User Group, and they've been very instrumental in helping us align our goals and our priorities throughout the harbor system. We're actually undergoing a $438 million construction project of the former Kapalama Military Reserve to build more cargo yard, just to keep up with the demand that, that I was talking about.
That 99%?
Yeah. We just run out of space, you know?
Oh, very good. Yeah. So when you mention working with the Coast Guard and you mentioned looking for things to do with TOD, you know, so this is an energy show. So immediately energy kind of resources come to mind. So if you can kind of help paint the landscape of what energy use looks like at the harbors.
Okay, so one of the major projects that we're doing under Director Fujigami is a energy savings performance contract with Johnson Controls, Inc. What we're doing is an $18 million contract over the next 2 years with guaranteed savings of about 45% of our energy usage. 61% will be coming from retrofitting our high mast lighting. Those are the tall 80-foot lights that you see at the cargo yard.
Right.
38% will come from photovoltaic cells, and 1% will come from changing our air conditioning controls in our major terminals, our passenger terminals. But we're looking forward to it because it actually, in changing out the high mast lighting, unfortunately, it'll change it for some of the television stations that use Honolulu Harbor as a background, and you have the nice lighting in the background. Well, we have a lot of overbleed now with the high-pressure sodium lights that we use. Mm-hmm. So these will be encased LED lights that have variable controls. So on nights that the shippers aren't shipping, they'll be able to actually turn it off.
I see.
And just leave it on for security purposes.
Oh.
So turn it on for work purposes, turn it off for security purpose. I mean, we think that, that's great. So,
wow.
So the 45% saving was just changing the fixture.
Right.
The ability to turn it on and off will actually generate more savings.
I see. And so you mentioned the shippers will be able to do that. That will be something that each individual shipper will be responsible for?
Yeah, so, and it'll actually be smart control. So whoever they assign the controls to on their yards will have, through either iPads or iPhones, be able to turn the lights off. So on a single head, if you think of like a caterpillar with many legs, you can put the individual heads on any of those legs. And so you could look at it and go, okay, of the 8 heads I have there, I can turn off 6 and leave 2 on.
Oh, wow, that much
control. Yeah, that much control.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
It is. It is for us because, you know, then again, the more energy that they can save, the less likely we are to continue to raise or we can kind of control costs of shipping. And help the consumer as well.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
So I'm not terribly familiar with happenings at harbors.
Okay.
Like in my mind, you know, a ship comes in, stuff comes off, it goes back out. But if you could talk a little bit about, so if they have that opportunity to turn on when they're there and turn off, like what time frames and kind of what movement does
that look like? Oh, okay, so Honolulu Harbor is actually a 24-hour harbor.
Okay.
Yeah, so certain harbors, Kalailoa, Barbers Point, certain ones on our neighbor islands, they're only daylight only. And that's for navigational purposes.
I see.
Just because of Honolulu's prominence, it's a 24-hour operation. So the ability to turn lights on and off will be great for them. And again, we're also changing out some of our interior and exterior lights as well.
Okay. So some of the fuel usage,
well,
obviously, is on the vessels themselves.
Yeah.
Does harbors engage with the shippers in that regard? Like, what sort of interaction takes place there?
Well, it's interesting that you ask. In the conversations that have come up regarding the shipment of LNG for transportation fuels, we're starting this far in advance to figure out whether or not are you asking for a permanent terminal? Are you asking for just lay down areas, and when I say lay down areas, just like more like a parking lot area where you can park your containers of pressurized gas. And so we ask that whoever is looking at an alternative fuel or bridge fuel, talk to us well in advance.
I see.
So as we start to plan how the harbor will look in the next 20 years.
Okay. And are some of those concerns in planning safety concerns?
Safety as well. And depending on what's being shipped. Is it flammable? Is there explosive capability? You know, how do we guard our assets there as well and the people that work there?
Okay. And so in planning the harbors, then I guess I'm trying to think of what that looks like. So if you know that I'm bringing something that's highly flammable, what sort of infrastructure would the Harpers need to implement?
Well, we need to work with the Coast Guard to make sure that we have the adequate safety zones and operating, that there's no open source anywhere near where you are at the time that you're discharging.
I see. Yeah. Okay. Well, it sounds like there's great things ahead. Yeah, we'll get back to more of that in just a moment. But for now, we'll take a break, and we'll see you in just a few.
Hi, my name is Stan Osterman, and I host the show every Friday here on ThinkTech Hawaii called Stan the Energy Man. We talk about everything energy, from anaerobic digesters to batteries to hydrogen fuel cell and grid power. And we do that to keep you informed on the latest technology that's out there and the things that are going on in Hawaii. We broadcast every Friday from noon until 1 o'clock, and I hope you'll tune in. So sometimes we'll be on ThinkTech, and sometimes we'll be on Ōlelo Channel 54, and I'd like you to listen in to me and join me every Friday. We'll see you then. Aloha.
Aloha! How you doing? It's me, Angus McTech, wishing you to welcome and join us to see us on Hibachi Talk on ThinkTech Hawaii. Join my co-hosts, Gordo the Texar and Andrew the Security Guy, every Friday from 1300 to 1345. We look forward to seeing you. We'll talk tech and we'll have some wee bit of fun. And remember, let your wing gang free wherever you be. Aloha!
Thank you for staying tuned. We appreciate you joining us here on Stan the Energy Man. I'm Rachel, the Energy Woman, guest hosting for Stan, who's off today. And here we have today with us Darrell Young from Department of Transportation Harbors. And we've been chatting a bit about some of the things Harbors has coming up, but then also some of the opportunities for partnership that the Harbors has.
Right.
And so I'm minimally familiar with the project, primarily because of the hydrogen element of it. But there's a project with Young Brothers and Sandia Laboratories, I understand.
So Young Brothers is looking at a fuel cell, and it shows promise. It's to replace the diesel engine power cells that they have, the diesel-powered power cells that they have, that they use to keep the refrigerated containers cool on the vessel journeys. You know, we understand, like with any new technology, there are ups and downs, and there is some overheating issues as it relates to our humidity. And I know they're trying to work their way through it. And again, it shows a lot of promise. With hydrogen, you know, right now we have to figure out if it continues, how do we refuel these cells?
Right
now the cell is going to Hickam to get refueled versus the fuel coming to the pier, right? And as we talked earlier, we have to figure out how we would deal with the safety zones and the hazard zones if it does come.
Okay. And so in that type of a partnership, I understand that that project specifically has a number of partners. So there's the Department of Energy, the Federal Department of Transportation, so Sandia Laboratories. Mm-hmm. But so coordination's at that level. I guess what sort of input does Department of Harbors here in the state have?
Well, it's good. We have a really good working relationship with our users. We have a group called the Hawaii Harbors User Group. 23-member group made up of shippers, of tugboat operators, of pilots. Coast Guard is part of it. And again, we kind of just share ideas. We meet once a month to talk about the harbors, and we use them more like our board of directors.
Oh, I see.
You know, we're one of the few states remaining that has a state-run Department of Transportation. A lot of them have gone toward semi-private, semi-autonomous port authorities.
Okay.
And unfortunately, our legislation this year was set aside to put priority on trying to establish an airport authority. And once we get that, you know, we'll follow. But, you know, we would look at it in those kind of terms where we're the operating side of it. We go to our board of directors and say, hey, what do you think about these ideas?
Mm-hmm.
With regard to the hydrogen project in and of itself, we had a lot of advance notice and planning with Young Brothers as one of our key tenants.
Okay.
You know, they're a longtime company here, and we appreciate the fact that they gave us that much notice to kind of work with them in trying to find safety zones, trying to find ways to make this happen, both for the company as well as for the state.
Oh, outstanding.
Yeah.
It's encouraging to hear those sort of collaborative opportunities that go well.
Yeah.
Sometimes when you get a lot of people in the room, you ever wonder if anything's going to get done.
Well, you know, one thing good under Director Fuchigami, you know, we're starting to do a lot more coal division planning as well.
Okay.
For example, the new legislation that came out for highway funding called FAST, puts a lot of emphasis on the movement of freight. Okay. So we're working with our highways division to make sure that our key arterials are open in the event of any type of catastrophe.
I see.
With regard to our airport brothers, we're working in trying to find and identify additional fuel storage in the Kona area specifically as they work toward getting international designation for the Kona airport. Again, this is all part of resiliency planning and where, you know, should anything happen to Honolulu International Airport, we have an alternate port in order to get our international tourists back home.
I think that's really important. You touched on something that in energy we speak of often. Yeah. So we speak about resiliency and sustainability and that ability to have redundancy.
Right.
And so that what was the term you used? The co-planning kind of model.
Yeah,
I appreciate that you all are able to do that with Harbors.
Yeah. So it's a great team that Ford and Governor Ige put together in transportation. So we really enjoy working with them.
No, I agree. Ford Fujikami has been remarkable in really implementing some forward-thinking things.
So. Yeah, and I think it's primarily his background in the hospitality side, where customer service and I guess the experience is what it's all about.
Yes. So you also touched on something. So with the hydrogen project and looking at doing things differently at the harbors and looking at fuel opportunities on neighbor islands, can you talk a little bit about what that connection looks like between the islands? Because oftentimes we hear about neighbor islands and it seems very far away.
Like,
what are they doing
over there? So if you're talking about our top two peers in terms of volume are the two in Honolulu, of course. Honolulu tends to be... Honolulu Harbor tends to be the primary hub for containerized cargo, whereas Kalailoa Barbers Point is our primary hub for fuel and bulk cargo, sand, gravel, coal, cement. So you take those two large entities and you have to have an entity on each island that kind of puts the two together.
Okay.
So we're on the neighbor island, it's not uncommon for us to, let's say for Hilo, we have a cruise ship and a cement ship at the same time and have to manage how we're moving both sides safely.
I see.
But I mean, like I said, to me, it's a really awesome job. And I have great people that do a great job in what they do.
Good. Now, that helps me understand better the importance. I'm certainly an advocate for planning, but planning that safety element because you have those very different types coming into the same space.
Yeah.
Planning for various alternative fuels could certainly, it'd be better to know sooner than later.
Yeah. And again, I actually am fortunate to be at the helm at this right time where we're actually doing a lot of improvements throughout the harbor system. As I said earlier, we're looking at a $438 million container yard in the old Kapalama Military Reservation.
Mm-hmm.
We're also looking at approximately $112 million worth of improvement at Kalailoa to build a dedicated fuel pier in order to free up some of the space that we have there.
Mm-hmm.
We just finished about $100 million in Hilo to create more cargo space and more passenger space there. So it's just a really good time, and we're trying to look at different ways to raise revenue without raising tariffs.
I see.
So that we can bring in revenues to fund our operation but not necessarily affect the cost of cargo.
Right.
So some of that is we just did an event in our Pier 2 passenger terminal for Hawaii Community Foundation.
Oh, okay.
And it's to celebrate their centennial. Mm-hmm. It was really great. And we actually transformed that into, to me, it was like a night of magic. You had, you know, models that were looking like statues and doing different types of posing.
Mm-hmm.
There was murals going on. There was a lot of networking there.
Right.
And so it's something that we want to continue to see if we can do. On dark nights where we don't have anything there for the state and we're not generating revenue, is there an opportunity for us to raise revenue? And we'll take a look at it.
I see. So you mentioned earlier moving toward a port authority.
Mm.
So what difference is that between what's happening now? Like what?
So in the mainland, a port authority is more, it can either be elected or it can be hired. Usually the commissioners are elected, they hire their executive director, but it runs more like a corporation than it does a government entity.
I see.
But it also has that flexibility in order to react and adapt quicker
to
changing market trends and concerns.
Okay. And does that change your engagement with the user at all, or is it more from kind of a planning and administrative standpoint?
More planning and administrative standpoint. Now you have more. We're trying to do that as well under the management team I have. We're trying to, you know, create cost centers, create, you know, profitability areas. And when I say profitability, just don't lose money kind of a thing.
Keep everyone
employed. Right.
Good. That's good to hear. I appreciate you mentioning Ford Fujikami as well as Governor Ige forming this great team.
Yeah.
Governor Ige recently signed on to a governor's accord for a new energy future, which is an agreement essentially between 17 states across the nation. And so in reviewing some of those plans, there's an area specific to transportation.
Right.
And I found it interesting that 11 of those 17 are actually states that have harbors.
Right. Oh.
And so you were saying that it's more common in the mainland to have this port authority structure.
Yes.
And so I wondered if there was any engagement with some of those authorities across the
nation. Well, we actually, with HUG last year, we took a trip to take a look at the management structures of three port authorities. One was the Port of San Diego.
Okay.
One was the Port of Long Beach, and one was the Port of Oakland. Mm-hmm. And in looking at it, Oakland kind of is more like us than Long Beach or San Diego. San Diego has a lot more commercialization and public areas than we do.
Oh, I see.
Long Beach has a lot more cargo areas than we do. So, again, it's a matter of priority on how those cities operate.
I see. Okay. So with that in mind, in those meetings and kind of those observations, and we hear often of California when we speak about energy initiatives, I wondered what kind of, I guess, what sort of integration does energy planning have in those?
Well, for us, we want to be open as much as possible for alternative fuels, bridge fuels, that kind of thing. But as I said earlier, we just ask that whoever's planning that, come and meet with us and let's talk story and see what kind of space needs you have. What we don't want to do is end up having this great fuel and no space to put it.
Right.
You know, and then so that'll change the cost dynamics of their economic model as well.
I see. And so I'm curious then, if they just need to come and talk to you, how is it? Would it be user-led, or if there are community groups, let's say there's a company that has this alternative fuel and they'd like to bring it to the harbor, is that a conversation they begin with you, or do they need to start with the user and see if it would be used?
Yeah, it can do both ways.
Okay.
We're open to just have that discussion, just to see. You know, where are you? How far are you down the pipe?
Mm-hmm.
What is it that you need? What does your distribution look like?
Okay.
Do you need pipelines or, you
know,
again, if it's pipelines, it's yours. It's not ours. but all those discussions, I think, you know, we need to just have up front. And I'm glad that you brought it up. We're actually in about 60 days are going to do an update of the Honolulu Harbor Master Plan.
Okay.
And the last update we did was kind of toward the mid to late 90s. And our industry has changed so much since then. If you recall, back in the mid to late 90s, you really didn't have this proliferation of big box retailers.
Mm-hmm.
And we still had the mom and pop distributors. Our cargo was coming in shrink wrapped on pallets, coming in kind of loose. You saw a lot more flatbeds with the cargo on the back. Now everything's coming in containers. And that's the need for why we need to build that new container yard.
I see.
So it changed the dynamics of weight, weight distribution, how you handle that whole thing.
Oh, fascinating.
So, you know, I end up with a lot of warehouses that we really don't need right now. So we're trying to figure out what we do with those as well.
Okay. And so some of that master planning, how far out is that?
This plan will do 25 years. It'll take about 2 years to complete. So again, we're starting in about 60 days, but it'll take about 2 years to complete.
Okay.
But some of the concepts that we want to introduce, as I explained, as we start to change from the mode of how we distribute cargo, we have areas in which that are closer toward town that we're looking at and going, you know, we're really not going to put cargo there anymore.
I see.
For example, near Aloha Tower. We have this big pad, but it acts more like a parking lot. Can we get more use out of that parking lot by putting a structure there?
Hmm.
Parking garage, hotel.
Right.
And again, when I say hotel, I'm not talking like a tall high rise. More like a boutique hotel that would accommodate the cruise ship passengers.
I see.
on this one that we have near the flour mill. Can I take a concept like the airport industrial multiplex and put it there?
Okay.
And would that help with some of these businesses that are getting displaced in Kakaako and Ivalay? You know, so how do I do land use planning and do
that?
And again, as we build these new buildings, I start to get more energy efficient use out of those yards.
Right. That's super encouraging to hear. Yeah. I like that. And I'll probably tease you a bit, but from going land to sea, it's nice to see the input that both sides are having to have this happy medium. We'll talk a little bit more about that after the break, but thanks for staying with us.
Aloha, namaskar, and hello. My name is Anu Hittel, and I host a show, Climate Change Beyond Outrage. In it, we go beyond outrage to look at solutions to climate problems facing people, nations, and the world. Join me every Tuesday at 1 o'clock Hawaii Standard Time. See you then.
Okay, I'm Jay Fidel. That's Ray Starling. We co-host a show called Hawaii, the State of Clean Energy, every Wednesday, 4 to 5 p.m. It's really interesting. You know, Ray has a way of unzipping these guys. He asks them these questions, and all this stuff tumbles out, and we find out stuff we would never know about without Ray's questions. Thank you, Ray.
You're welcome, Jay. I'm very pleased to be your Ed McMahon every Wednesday at 4 o'clock here on the Internet. So you can join us and see what's happening in the energy world, and there is a lot going on. So join us every Wednesday at 4 o'clock.
Yeah, come around. Be energized right here on ThinkTech. Aloha.
Thank you for hanging with us. We've got a little bit more time this afternoon. And we're here with Darrell Young from Department of Transportation Harbors Division, who's a deputy director. Darrell, I've really enjoyed speaking with you this past...
I've enjoyed it as well.
So we've talked about a few things. We've talked about what you've done and how your land-based management has informed your harbors management. We've talked a bit about the things that harbors has coming up in the future. So talked about some of the exploration in hydrogen energy, your engagement with community partners, both federal and, well, everybody really. It seems like you're open for everyone to come and speak with you. And so before we went to the break, you touched on an upcoming master plan.
Right.
And so you mentioned a little bit that opportunity is going to cover 25 years' time.
Right.
Could you speak about some of the community engagement in that process?
Okay, so what we're doing is we're contracting with RMTAL, one of the more respected planning organizations throughout the state, to begin this talk story session with the public on how they envision what Honolulu Harbor looks like, keeping in mind that we have to move a lot of cargo, but there are areas in which we can take a look at, while it's being maritime related, also be open to the public.
I see.
And that's the only catch that we have with our lands. It has to be maritime related.
Okay.
So is it shipping? Is it, you know, education of the harbor, that kind of a thing? One of the key facets in our plan that we want to kind of put out there for the public is, it's kind of a personal thing to me as well. What I'd really love to see is us restore Irwin Park to its full park use, to have this green gem within Honolulu.
Mm-hmm.
But in order for me to do so, I need to replace the parking that's on there right now.
I see.
And so that's why we said that there might be an opportunity for a parking garage and another facility, whether it's an office building or small hotel or what have you. To accommodate that. And again, it'll be right where one of the rail stops is. Mm-hmm. You have this beautiful park there. The park will probably be turned over to HPU or the shopping center management as part of a great lawn concept with that private entity, but open to the public. So to me, that's really great. You know, the more green space that we can, the more rooftop parks that we can do, I think all the better.
I'm there with you 100%. You've got a believer in me.
Oh, good. So
I think it's really fascinating that so much of our, like so much of what we do here on the islands, whether it's food or kind of what we do in our leisure time, so much of that comes through the harbors.
Yeah.
There is, I'd say there are a number of efforts that are looking to localize things more, so to certainly decrease the amount that's imported.
Yeah.
And so as efforts like that increase and continue, what sort of engagement with harbors has taken place, and kind of what do you see the future of that being?
It's kind of difficult because when you look at it, I mean, as much as I would love to see more produce grown here, it's just the cost of water, cost of land, and you take a look at that. Can there be a balance? Is that balance going to be more than 20%? I'm not certain.
I see.
I just think just our isolation alone and some of the legislation that's tied to it, you know, kind of dictates that mix. But where we are is how do we build what we need to build and still keep costs as far down as possible?
I see.
And again, as we translate the cost to Honolulu residents, there's another layer that goes to our neighbor island.
I see.
Because there's another level of shipping that goes there. So
we
try to be as cognizant as we can of all the moving pieces.
Okay. Well, it's certainly a number of moving pieces.
But we have good partners as well, you know. Young Brothers, Pesha, Matson, you know, great partners.
Good to hear. Yeah. So it's interesting when I think of the movement between the neighbor islands and then between here and the mainland, and I think about, like I mentioned, that kind of, there's a movement to decrease that. It's encouraging to hear that you're looking into other areas. So mentioning those parking structures and renewing green spaces and just kind of reaching out beyond the harbor to still have impact in the community and sustain the mission of the harbors.
Yeah.
I find that encouraging.
Well, good. Thanks. You know, and again, we're not trying to keep it only to Honolulu. There's actually efforts to take a look at what we can do on our neighbor islands as well, on facilities that we have there.
Outstanding. And so next to Honolulu, you mentioned some of the other harbors are kind of dual use, where you mentioned like concrete and commerce.
Yeah.
What opportunities do you see in some of the neighbor island harbors?
So some of the things that we're trying to do with the neighbor island harbors that we're trying to explore right now, and it's still really just in the exploration stage, is trying to get a better grasp, a better partnership with our Native Hawaiian community there.
I see.
We're actually going to be floating a revocable permit for the Keaukaha Community Association to allow them use of this land that they've had for a little while under their care as a guardianship for us. It's actually a vacant piece of parcel that we would actually have to expend monies on. But in partnering with this community, it creates a learning opportunity for impoverished kids in Keaukaha to learn navigation skills.
Oh, wow.
And then I hope, being a Native Hawaiian as well, a graduate of Kamehameha, that it could translate for them having jobs in the maritime field.
I see.
As a pilot, as a ship's captain. You know, so do we plant the seed here working with the community and have greater and reap that reward later on? You know, I'd love to see that happen.
Yes, as would I. Yeah. As would I. And so, hearkening back to an earlier conversation we started, speaking about Port Authority and the flexibility that having that kind of designation would afford, when you think of moving in a Port Authority kind of way, I suppose, partnerships like these, what do you see as the more beneficial element of a Port Authority?
The more beneficial element of the Port Authority is actually that it wouldn't have to go through a lot of the government processes that we go through right now.
Okay.
And it's not that it's bad, it's just that in doing so, it's a little bit more cumbersome than being able to react quickly. For example, procurement is needed, but sometimes procurement takes a lot longer than necessary, or not necessary, than wanting.
I see.
You know, it'll stretch you out a little bit longer. And sometimes within the process itself, although it's not wrong, there are protest situations in there where it can hang up a contract for a long time.
I see.
You know, versus, you know, under Port Authority, the Port Authority can make the decision and they're just going to go.
Okay.
You know, again, it's how do you balance that? How do you balance the protection of the rights of people to bid and procure versus expediency and efficiency?
Right. Yes. No, and we hear efficiency a great deal in energy. We talk about energy efficiency all day long. So I definitely understand efficient processes.
Yeah.
So as you're growing spaces, and you mentioned hopefully building them if they go through, building more energy efficient spaces.
Yes.
And then I'm curious though, so working with partners and working with community members and people who bring to the table something they'd like to see implemented at the harbors, what is the process that would need to take place? So if there's a conversation, does the conversation lead to a working group? Or like, how does that, if the idea is good, what does implementation look like now?
Well, usually what we ask them to do is start either with myself or my property management team, and just having that initial conversation. What is it that you need? What is it that you're looking for? What is it that you can afford? Mm-hmm. You know, and looking in those terms. Everything that we do is based upon the maritime usage, is based upon fair market value return to the state, and trying to see how that niche will fit.
I see.
You know, is there any type of exemption or any kind of discount that we can give based upon what they're doing? Maybe for a startup.
Okay.
But when does that kick to fair market rent? And
right.
As it kicks to fair market rent, can they, you know, survive that transition?
I see. That's good. I appreciate you hearing about keeping the startups.
Yeah.
Good. Keep the startups there. Because so many startup, as quick as they start up, you know, they fall through that gap, and sometimes they don't always make it.
Right,
so having that upfront conversation sounds like it would be worthwhile.
So it's kind of working with them and seeing what their financing looks like in order for them to make that
yes, the leap, that great chasm.
Yeah.
They get stuck.
Yeah.
So I'm encouraged. Again, this conversation has been pretty encouraging.
Yeah.
I enjoy maritime activities myself, to hear about the commerce and the cargo with things I don't generally engage in, but still are happening on the waters, it's good to hear that Harbors is so proactive in planning and managing that.
Yeah, thanks.
So there's a few more things I wanted to touch on. We've talked a bit about opportunities for community engagement and businesses and just kind of hearing the voice of the users. And so as we think about renewable energy and alternative energy and we talk about kind of planning and changing landscapes and moving towards different management models, when we do that, the opportunities to engage are there.
Yes.
But there's also that opportunity to have one too many cooks in the
kitchen. Right.
So you highlighted something earlier where you said it's make sure that the focus is a maritime focus.
Yes.
Can you expand on that?
Okay, so our lands are governed through Hawaii Revised Statutes, Chapter 266, and all our lands have to have a maritime purpose.
Okay.
The use on it, whether it be shipping, storage, cargo, even to some extent the proposed new uses that I'm talking about.
Okay.
We're gonna have to have some element of maritime within it.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, you know, again, the distribution of bulk fuels, that's
mm-hmm.
maritime.
Mm-hmm.
As we get into, is it bulk and then it turns to retail, that's where we gotta kind of take a look at how that, you know, bridges that zoning issue. Mm-hmm.
But you still seem like you have an opportunity, because you mentioned that education element.
Right.
And so you have an opportunity to kind of grow into maritime.
Yeah.
Can you talk about how community organizations that exist currently? So, for instance, I have a 9-year-old.
Okay.
And I'm thinking of, elementary school field trips.
Yeah,
like,
what
can she learn about Harbors? So can you talk about how the community is more aware of this type of efforts?
Yeah. Well, again, it was there, and it kind of waned, and we're trying to bring it back.
Okay.
For example, one of the things that we're looking at is in our passenger terminal, and I'll relate it to the cruise ship site. In our passenger terminal, we have a theme in our main terminal of navigation by the stars.
Okay.
One of the things we're thinking about is working with the Bishop Museum in getting a 44-foot double hull canoe on loan so that when the visitors come, they can see the canoe.
Oh,
and
I
then
see.
Go on the cruise,
right. Go
there, hit Kahului, and maybe see a canoe in Kahului Harbor.
Mm-hmm.
Take a ride on that. Go to Hilo, and like I said, there would be the canoe there with the Keokaha Community Association. You know, come around, go to Kona, that's with the Department of Land and Natural Resources, then come back and hit Kauai and hopefully have something there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then maybe come back here and we home port one of our, you know, more famous sailing canoes near Uncles and Nikos.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is that something that we can do as a theme? Is that something we can do? And again, then the kids can come and kind of get that.
Right.
You know, that's how it all fits. It started with our culture, it comes back. It's in this commercialization, but we didn't stray too far away from where we started.
That is an honorable mission.
Yeah.
And I look forward to seeing that come to fruition.
Yeah.
I've appreciated you taking your time with us today.
Well, thank you so much.
A number of things. And I'm hopeful that our audience has taken this opportunity to engage with Department of Harbors, Harbors Division, Department of Transportation. So the call is there.
Yeah.
Community members, if you're interested, Darrell Young or his staff are the people that you need to speak with. And so we're encouraged by what you've shared. We're hopeful for what will happen in the future. And we appreciate you taking your time with us today.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.